Ladies and gentlemen, girls and boys, a very good morning to all present over here. This is Deepika Nandanar from GHRI Sony Institute of Management and Research. From the bottom of my heart, I'm welcoming you all to the second edition of a virtual Orange City Literature Fest organized by SGR Knowledge Foundation. Today, on 20th November, we are having our very first session of a virtual Orange City Literature Fest on the topic of Dashavatara for 5 to 12 years of age by one and only Piyusha Veer. Piyusha Veer is a writer, blogger, workshop facilitator, and a CELTA certified English language teacher. Ma'am was awarded the top 5 position in the Orange Flower Awards 2018 in the category of writing for social impact and was one of the finalists in 2020 in the category of humor. Ma'am has been published in the 2 multi-author anthologies, Mock, Stock, Quarrel, and the Radiomania Book of Indian Mythology. After just another day, an e-book of thriller short stories, Dashavatara, Stories of Lord Vishnu, Radiomania published on Dashavatara for children, is her third book. Now, I would like to hand over this session over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Deepika. And thank you, Orange City Literature Festival, for having me. I would love to talk about why mythology is relevant even more today. But even before I start, I just want you to give a few seconds of thought to why and what is it about mythology and mythological stories that were written thousands of years ago that makes them worth reading even today? And why now more than ever? I remember when I was a kid, my parents and I would huddle around the TV every Sunday to watch the weekly telecast of the Mahabharata TV series by B.R. Chopra. Those were the times when we didn't have internet, Tata Sky, and YouTube. So you either watched the telecast live when it aired or you missed it completely. Obviously, no one wanted to miss it. So the entire country would be glued in front of their TV sets. Imagine shops being closed, roads being deserted. No visitors were expected during that 1 hour when the latest episode would be telecast. In fact, I remember long after the series ended, my father used to jokingly remark, "It's incredible how the entire country would come to a standstill for that 1 hour." Even today, when I recall my childhood, I am reminded of how that show was an important and integral part of my growing up years. The title song of the show is ingrained in my memory forever. Every time the voice sang, "Bharat ki hai ye kahani," I used to sing along with it. I wouldn't do that now because I'm a terrible singer and I don't want to put you to sleep. But I especially love the line which calls it a Gyan ki Ganga. Although I think they got the geography wrong, it's more an ocean of knowledge than a river. But I would love to know from you, what is your favorite part of the Mahabharata story? Share in comments and I will keep reading them as I go along. I think it was because of the childhood experience that Mahabharata always had more fascination for me. Strangely, I don't think Ramayana at that time intrigued me so much. Until a fellow blogger and a dear friend recommended Kavita Kane's book Sita Sister. So this book Sita Sister is a retelling of Ramayana through Urmila's perspective. And I think that was the first time I realized the same story could be told through a different perspective and would look completely different. That is when my interest in mythology was rekindled as an adult. I then picked up The Palace of Illusions, which is still my favorite book. That was the first book I read on the Mahabharata. And since it's from Draupadi's point of view, it gave me an entirely new perspective to the already well-known epic. When reading Palace of Illusions, my understanding of the mythological narrative went far deeper than it originally had been when I was a child. It whetted my appetite even more for such stories. And it sent me scurrying to YouTube to rewatch all the episodes of the original TV show. And suddenly I was watching the show with a completely new understanding because now I could see there was far more to the story than I had originally understood. There were so many layers, complexities that I had earlier remained hidden. And another book which delves into this deeper and is another favorite of mine and looks at Mahabharata from a different perspective is Malhar Chatterjee's Yudhishthira, the Unfallen Pandava. So this is the autobiography of Yudhishthira, obviously imaginary. And it was during reading this book that it was evident to me even more that nothing is what it seems. What goes on in people's minds, their motivations, how they act, how they behave, how they decide things, how they make the decisions and choices is very different from what the original had shown to us. What's commendable in both of these books, and which struck me as remarkable, was that the causes of the war, the events that unfolded or did not, the consequences of Kauravas and Pandavas actions and decisions, or even the lack of it, are worth analyzing, but the author makes no comment on them, so that it's left to the reader's judgment. The books made no conclusion on any of those aspects of the story. It made me question everything I knew about Mahabharata so far. In fact, it even made me wonder the importance of one question: if the inevitable war could actually have been avoided. It dawned on me then that there are far more layers and perspectives that still remain unexplored. What appears on the surface may be very different from what it really is. And I think this is true not just for these two epics, which are Mahabharata and Ramayana, but also for other mythological stories. So if you have to look at an example from a simple story, the story of the elephant and three blind mice comes to mind. You're seeing only part of the bigger picture, like a jigsaw puzzle, and you can see only one part at a time. It's only when the entire picture comes together that you know what it really is. So I think perceptions, experiences, what conclusion you draw from those perceptions and experiences may be very different, because our own individual perceptions and experiences are so different. It's only when you have the entire puzzle together that you see what the entire picture is. And the stories are not just what we see on the surface. There are layers and complexities. And that's the reason why we need to expose ourselves to so many different versions. Like in Ramayana, for example, we think it's a simple story, right? Ravana was evil. He kidnapped Sita. Ram went and fought against Ravana, defeated him, and brought his wife back. So Ram is good and Ravana is evil. But we also need to keep asking questions like, what is evil? Is Ravana really evil, or are we making him look evil? What if none of this had happened? What if Lakshman had not even cut Surpanakha's nose? Furthermore, questions like, what lessons can we imbibe from these characters in these stories? Can we really be ideal human beings like the characters in mythological stories? Or are the characters actually flawed, just like we humans are? Is it okay to play games against someone and manipulate them for our own selfish reasons? Or is doing this justified when it is only for a greater good, like Krishna says? I think in trying to look for these answers to these particular questions, we can figure out, by deriving our own answers, how we should live our lives. It's evident, isn't it, that we need to stop taking these stories at literal value, and we need to dig deeper and understand the contextual meanings and interpretations. These deeper meanings and messages, despite the minute differences, will tell us, and there are many differences in the different books and texts. There exist huge different versions and different accounts and different stories. And I think in reading all of those, we can piece our jigsaw puzzle together. So, and it used to make me wonder a lot how to reconcile these differences. But I think after a particular point, I came to the conclusion that the lessons and the takeaways aren't in the details. They're not hidden in the differences. It's in the story themselves. So while we consume the story for entertainment and education, they also hold a lot of wisdom. And like I said, we need to constantly ask these questions and derive our own interpretations. Like the 10 avatars of Lord Vishnu, for example, there are so many different versions and stories. In fact, even the list of 10 avatars have different versions. There's no single list which lists the 10 avatars, and there's no general consensus on it. Some versions include some avatars of Lord Vishnu, some versions include some other avatars. As per this particular book, which is based on the popular belief, the 10 avatars that I have gone with are Matsya, which is a fish, Kurma, which is a tortoise, Varaha, which is a boar, Narsimha, which is half man, half lion, because Nar is man and Simha is lion, and then the human avatars, which is Vaman, Parshuram, Ram, Krishna, Buddha, and Kalki. So as per some lists, Buddha is not an avatar of Vishnu. As per some lists, he is. And of course, Kalki was yet to arrive. Each of these avatars are said to have manifested on Earth to annihilate evil and restore the balance, to bring back values of peace, love, righteousness to an otherwise fragmented world. And each avatar fulfilled its purpose in its own peculiar way. When we talk about otherwise fragmented world, does it not remind us of what we are today, the world that it is today? So interestingly, even though the stories have been told repeatedly, they are still interesting and fascinating despite the different versions, because they're still relevant. And because you're looking at a jigsaw puzzle using your own individual perceptions and interpretations, the stories will always have something to tell you, no matter which story you're reading or which at what time you're reading it. The messages and the morals are profound, as is the applicability of those values in the present times we live in. For me, it was important to explore as many different perspectives and versions as I could to be able to create a complete picture in my own head. Because, like I said, there was a point when I was actually questioning which version to go with, which story to tell. But even while writing these stories, I was extremely conscious about bringing out the aspect of the stories that make us wonder and think. And like I came to my own answers, I wanted my readers to also come to their own answers. So I did not want to spoon feed them the answers. As I continued my research and explored more and more stories, I realized that a lot of the stories and mythological teachings seemed to be out of context. They had apparently lost their relevance because the stories seem outdated. But are they really, is what I wanted to understand and explore. And I realized that while the stories had remained and we kept passing down the stories over the years, the messaging was getting lost. The world has obviously changed a lot from that time. There's more technology, there's more race for attention, there's a lot of different, our challenges are very different. The problems we face are very different, but the solution may well be the same. So that's the reason why I attempted to write these stories from a more contemporary perspective, and in the process explore how they're relevant. The stories themselves are a lot of fun, like I said. Somebody wants to become the most powerful in the world. Somebody wants revenge for the injustices they have suffered. Another person wants to be treated like God. Are these really that different from what we are today? Don't we want attention, power, control? Don't we want to inflict revenge on someone who has done wrong to us? So even though there's a lot of drama and entertainment, there's also a lot of relatability to our present day world. There's a lot of evil as well in these stories. And Lord Vishnu came in these different forms at different times. They're all called yugas. So it's four yugas: Satyug, Dwapar Yug, Treta Yug, and Kaliyug. And we're in Kaliyug right now. And Lord Vishnu came in these different times in different avatars or forms to save the world from evil. And every form came with a different purpose to fight a different enemy. But even as Lord Vishnu is changing his avatars and forms to fight the evil, it's also the evil which is undergoing a transformation. Sometimes it's one person who is evil. Sometimes it's a group of people who have lost their way and are indulging in evil deeds like being greedy or inflicting bad acts on others like crimes, etc. Sometimes it's a king who is evil because of certain vices like ego or greed. Like the king in Parshuram's story, for example, his name is Kartavirya Arjun or Ravana. But Lord Vishnu is all-powerful. So he is this mighty superhero who can stand against any enemy, no matter what boons they have. And all of these evils, all of these foes of Lord Vishnu have some really powerful boons, like invincibility or being all-powerful. And they take it all from Brahma. So Brahma is this... this trigger happy, like we call it. So he's this boon happy god who keeps doling out boons. Somebody prays to them, pleases them with their tapasya or their severe penances that they do, and Brahma is like, okay, I will give you this boon if you ask for it. And he does. So Lord Vishnu is the counter foil to that, and he defeats the enemy and he brings back goodness. And that's how each avatar of Lord Vishnu fulfills its purpose. So I will talk about a few examples to give to illustrate the point of how Lord Vishnu beats these evils and defeats the evil. The Matsya Avatar, for example, let's start with. It's believed he came into existence because there was too much evil in the world. And the only way Lord Vishnu could figure out to save the world was to click the reset button. You know how it happens on our phones? They suddenly stop working and then what do? We have to switch off and then switch on our phones again. So the phone starts working right after that, right? Lord Vishnu didn't have a reset button. So what did he do? He caused this great big flood and everything was destroyed in the flood. And then he created everything again. So he gave Manu, who was the first man in the new world a set of rules and said, you have to live by these rules. If you don't follow these rules, you will suffer. But rules are meant to be broken, right? We always break the rules, don't we? And then we suffer again. We become bad, we lie, we kill, we cheat, we become greedy and selfish. We even impose our opinions on others. We become revengeful. And then Lord Vishnu will have to come back again and save the world. Because if the world has gone wrong and people have lost their way, Lord Vishnu will not hesitate from starting afresh. He will clean everything off like a clean slate and he will begin again. Isn't that an important lesson for you and me as well? For example, if you're studying or painting or playing an instrument and we don't get it right, we get frustrated, don't we? But we forget that creating something takes time and there are so many things that may go wrong. These are the times when it is important for us to remember that we shouldn't hesitate to start again with a fresh mind. Just forget whatever you've done and begin again, maybe the next day or after a few hours, with a fresh perspective, fresh mind, give it another attempt. And then it'll happen, it'll work out the way you want it to. Another lesson I feel is there in this story is to be good. Because Lord Vishnu tells Manu, the people have become bad, they're resorting to evil deeds, and therefore he has to wipe everything off and create everything afresh. So that in the new world, they will follow the rules. But what does being good mean? Does it mean you have to be like God? Or that you have to constantly defend your God? No, it means being evil, away from evil deeds. Not being evil, which means just being kind to each other, listen to each other, have empathy, being there for your friends when they're in trouble. Like Krishna, for example, which is another avatar of Lord Vishnu and a very important story in this book. In this story, Krishna's best friend, who's Sudama, did not help Krishna when they were stuck in a forest and Krishna was hungry. So Sudama had this small packet of food, and when Krishna asked him, what are you eating? Sudama said, nothing, nothing, I don't have anything. It's just, it's my stomach which is rumbling, or maybe the birds, or maybe you're hearing sounds. And Sudama did not share his food with Krishna. But many years later, when Sudama needed help, what did Krishna do? He didn't say, I am God and you disrespected me at that time, so now I also won't help you. No. In fact, despite being a God, Krishna did not feel disrespected at all. He thought, never mind if my friend didn't help me at that time. Today, he needs my help and I should help him. And that's what friendship really is. It's not about taking revenge. It's not about doing things for each other only when others do it for you. It is appreciating what the friend is, to keep relationship and people as most important, and to not hold a grudge for little things. That's the meaning of being good. There are a lot of other lessons also which I think are there in the story. I personally firmly believe in the saying, for example, what goes round comes round. So if you do good, good will come back to you. And this is true not just in real life, but also in our mythological texts. There are so many instances and examples of this coming true in most of these stories, and even in characters and their lives, with a lot of actions and decisions that the characters take. For example, it often so happens that the consequences of one of the characters' actions in their particular lifetime are, they have to bear those consequences in another lifetime. This is a common occurrence, especially in case of Lord Vishnu and his avatars, including Ram and Krishna. So the story goes that Jaya and Vijaya, the gatekeepers at Vaikunth, which happens to be Lord Vishnu's heavenly abode, had been cursed by the four Sanat Kumaras. And Sanat Kumaras are Lord Brahma's children. So what Jaya and Vijaya did was, they insulted the four children, and the four Sanat Kumaras, the four children, cursed Jaya and Vijaya to be born as mortals. Because Jaya and Vijaya were very arrogant and they were very mean to the kids. So as per the curse, they would have to take rebirth and be defeated by Lord Vishnu, and this would happen thrice. So three rebirths, and in every lifetime, Lord Vishnu would defeat and kill them before they could return to Vaikunth. So this curse comes true in case of Varaha Avatar and Narasimha Avatar and Rama Avatar and Krishna. In Varaha Avatar and Narasimha Avatar, they're born as two twins, Hiranyakashipu and Hiranyakashipu, And as Ram avatar, Vishnu killed Ravan and Kumbhakaran, who were earlier Jaya and Vijaya. And as Krishna, he killed Shishupal and Dantavakra. But the thing is, even Ram and Krishna themselves weren't free from their own karma. They also had to bear the burden of their actions and decisions. Like, for example, as Ram, Vishnu was separated from his wife. And Krishna was killed by a stray arrow because of something he did earlier. So even for us, it's an important lesson that no matter what we are doing, whether it be good, whether it be bad, it will come back to us. The unpaid dues of one's life, whether they be settled in this lifetime or a subsequent one, will definitely happen. We may or may not believe in rebirth, but irrespective of that belief, it cannot be disputed that we are responsible for our own actions and we have to bear the consequences for them. You don't even need to believe in God to know that good actions based on love, kindness, and empathy will attract goodwill and positivity. In fact, even if you don't believe in karma, it may or may not be a real thing. The fact is your actions will come back to you tenfold, good and bad, both. So, and interestingly, it's not just facing the consequences of those actions, which are the takeaway from those stories. Most of these stories also talk about facing challenges and battling obstacles head on. And nothing, not even the wounds from gods, including the mighty Brahma, can save you from what's coming your way. So sometimes you just have to face things, even if things don't go the way you want them to. In those circumstances, there's literally nothing you can do but to trust the universe and hope that everything will work out in the end, especially if you've been good. If you've been bad, obviously, then the universe will give you tenfold bad things also. Anyway, coming back to the Ram avatar, for me, the most interesting avatar is Ram because unlike Krishna, interestingly, Ram doesn't believe he is God. He does not let people worship him during his lifetime. And he's extremely humble. But Krishna is fun, playful, calculative. He does not behave like a god. And that's the reason why in this particular book as well, Krishna's story is titled as the ungodlike god. So Krishna knows he's God, but he doesn't behave like a god. Ram, on the other hand, doesn't even know. He's a very simple person. He only knows one thing, and that is that he has to follow dharma. He has to follow the rules and he has to do what he's told to do. So daddy said, do this and he will do that. He was very obedient like that. Mama said, leave the house and he left the house. Everything he did it for the sake of his people because he considered it his duty. But there was also a problem. What could be the problem? The problem was he didn't ask questions at all. He just did what he was told. He never questioned, why should I do this? Why is this right? Why is this wrong? What will happen if I do this? And he did not understand the impact of the consequences of his actions. So he did not take his own decisions. He did what people told him to do. Because of this, sometimes he also ended up hurting people. Like his father was very hurt when Ram listened to his mother and left home and went into exile. So for me personally, this story teaches me the lesson that it is important to think about fulfilling other people's wishes to make them happy, but not blindly. So think about what they want and whether it's going to hurt somebody else or not. If those wishes are unfair or if they cost you or your loved one's happiness, then don't do it. You have to take your own decisions. So in a lot of these stories, there's a lot of learning on issues like gender equality, feminism, questioning religion, having faith but not blind faith, being tolerant to opinions and perspectives which are different from our personal opinions and perspectives. All of these are lessons which we can derive from mythology. Personally as well, I keep going back to mythology to remind myself of these lessons. And like I said, every time you read these stories, it will present something different. No wonder then that these stories and our fascination for the lessons embedded in these stories have proved timeless. And they can be adapted to different circumstances as per individual perspectives of the reader. But there's also the important aspect of needing to recognize the flaws. So the casteism, the blind belief in certain rituals and traditions without questioning them, the adherence to certain customs that are passed down the generations without realizing why those customs existed at that time and why they need to be done away with now, or even adapting them as per changing times, is important. If we refuse to see the metaphorical and contextual relevance of these stories, then we will probably miss the lessons also. In fact, in a lot of the stories that I'm reading currently and even researching right now, the moral takeaway is for believers to not believe blindly, but to question and continue the journey of exploring and learning based on own observations and experiences. And this is true in quite a few of the stories, because the characters tell the other characters, do this, but don't believe me. Figure it out for yourself. Or this is how it should be, but don't believe me. Find your own answers. And eventually the characters come to the same conclusion or the observation, and then they realize, yes, this particular learning is true. Or maybe they don't agree with it, and then they say, no, I don't want to do this. So you have to understand that reading mythology makes us aware and learned, but only when it's backed by your own experiences. And interestingly, no one book can do that in isolation. No one book can make you aware and enlightened. In fact, if anything, the many retellings of mythological stories make one thing very clear, that there is no right and wrong. What is right to you may be wrong to somebody else, and you have to respect that. What is wrong to you may be right for someone else, and you have to understand that. Of course, there are certain things which are completely wrong, like killing, for example, or being mean to each other, for example. But there is, and often I'm asked this question, so I want to address this as well. What is truth? Is it true that if you kill somebody, it's wrong? Is it true that if you do this, or if you don't pray to God, or if you don't question God, it's wrong? What is truth? So there's only one truth in my opinion, and I think the mythological texts also repeat this particular belief. There's only one truth which is not known to you. And you have to expose yourself to and explore different versions and different retellings and read the stories to expose yourself to that one truth which is not known to you. Only then will you get insight into how people behave, their motivations, etc. And these stories will help you make sense of the world around us, to help us understand the basic tenets of life, religion, what is right, what is wrong, what is completely right, what is completely wrong, what is the truth which is not known to me. So it will only come to you when you read all these different stories. It even answers, even in Rig Veda and in the Matsyavatara story, they answer some existential questions like, where did we come from? Which is a very different answer from the scientific explanation of how the world came into being. And you have to know both, I believe. So it's not that the world was created by Lord Brahma, so that's a truth. That is a mythological of what we believe. The scientific answer could be something else. And they also remind us of the virtues and values to live by. So obviously, there's a lot of value to be derived from these stories. They answer questions. They help us understand the basic tenets of life and religion. They help make sense of the world around us. They give us insight into how people behave and their motivations. They remind us of the virtues and values to live by. So obviously, there's a lot of value to be derived from these stories. But we need to turn to these stories again and again. We can't just read them once and forget them. That is not something which would help us in any way. So keep reading, keep questioning, apply them to the present day, extract the true values of the stories that guide us, not dictate, but come to your own conclusions and observations. And they tell you how to lead your life with virtues like empathy, honesty, devotion, how to make the best in difficult circumstances like we are in today, right? With COVID, we are all struggling in so many different ways. There's loss of jobs, livelihood, there are mental health issues, gender-based violence is on the rise. We need to come together as one people, be there for each other, stand up for each other, not be wasteful or greedy or selfish, but in fact help each other and provide resources exactly like Lord Vishnu would have done. And I think that's the reason why we need mythology more than ever before, not just for understanding the past, but also to derive the lessons that can help us cope with the present and prepare us for the future. Like the line in the closing sequence of B.R. Chopra's show goes, and I'm not going to sing this, I'm just going to tell you the words. Seek bandhu, बीते युगों से नए युग का करे स्वागत. सो लूजली ट्रांसलेटेड दिस लाइन मीन्स लर्न फ्रॉम द टाइम दैट इज पास्ट एंड वेलकम द टाइम दैट इज येट टू कम. आई थिंक दैट्स एन इम्पॉर्टेंट नोट टू एंड ऑन. लेट मी क्विकली रीड अ शॉर्ट एक्सट्रैक्ट फॉर यू फ्रॉम द राम अवतार स्टोरी. देर इज दिस सीन वेयर ऋषि विश्वामित्रा कम्स टू विजिट दशरथ एंड ही वॉन्ट्स हेल्प फ्रॉम राम एंड लक्ष्मण. सो विश्वामित्रा इज आस्किंग फॉर दशरथ टू सेंड हिज सन्स विद विश्वामित्रा बिकॉज द डेमन्स हैव बीन ट्रबलिंग विश्वामित्रा एंड ही नीड्स हेल्प टू डिफीट द डेमन्स. किंग दशरथ वॉज अगास्ट टू फाइट द डेमन्स. दे आर यंग बॉयज, नॉट इवन ग्रोन अडल्ट्स. I'd be sending them to that death if I were to agree to this request. Besides, I cannot bear to send them away like this. It would break our family apart. He shook his head violently. Vishwamitra, known for his temper, was furious. You just said, ask whatever you need, and now you're going back on your word? How was I to know what you would ask for, Vishwamitra? I have my entire army here, ready to go with you and protect your ashram. I'd gladly send my soldiers, who are trained in combat with enemies. But my sons are like pieces of my own heart. How can I send them with you? Vishwamitra said, your son Ram is capable of handling these demons on his own. You may not know it now, but this will bring him even more fame and respect. Oh king, have some trust and send them with me, he urged. Hearing this, Dashrath winced. Why had he agreed to Vishwamitra's request even before hearing him out? Vishwamitra continued, I wish to conduct an important yagna, and these demons won't let me complete it in peace. It is only your son who is a worthy match for them and can restore tranquility in the forest. Much against his wishes, and only upon intervention from Rishi Vasishtha, Dashrath finally relented, and Ram was sent with Vishwamitra. Unwilling to be parted from his elder brother, Lakshman too went with them. On the way to the forest, Ram and Lakshman focused on understanding the lay of the land. Where are the forests? Where are the water stream? Where are the rocks? They would have to go several days without food or water, the Rishi warned them. The enemies would be many and quite ferocious, he said. Ram and Lakshman listened to his instructions carefully and nodded their heads in acknowledgement. They would be prepared, they assured him. The trio soon encountered the demons that Vishwamitra had been talking about. There she is! That's Taraka! Cried Vishwamitra when he spotted her from a distance. She and her children Maricha and Subahu have made it impossible for me to chant even two mantras in peace. Kill her! Kill them all! Ram and Lakshman could only stare ahead, even as Taraka saw them and growled in anger. It's a woman! The demon harassing you is a woman! Lakshman blurted. The two boys looked at Vishwamitra in surprise. What is it? Why aren't you stringing your bows? Vishwamitra asked anxiously. Ram looked at the demon charging towards him and stepped back. He lowered his gaze and replied to Vishwamitra. We apologize. This will anger you, but it is a woman. We cannot attack a woman, that too one who holds no weapon in her hands. Vishwamitra threw up his hands in despair. Woman or man, a demon is a demon. You must kill her and restore peace to the forest. And as far as weapons are concerned, she needs none. She breathes fire and throws anything she can get her hands on. No sooner had the Rishi said this than the boulders began raining on them. Ram raised his bow and shot off several arrows in quick succession to block the volley of stones and rocks. Seeing this, Taraka became even more furious. I will eat you up alive, all of you, she growled and prepared to hurl bigger rocks at them. But the two warriors had already taken positions. Instantly, Ram and Lakshmana shot arrows at the demon, cutting off her arms. They were still hesitant to kill her and hoped to weaken her enough to make her retreat of her own accord. but Ram had underestimated his opponent. Taraka, with her ability to transform herself, became invisible and continued raining boulders on them. "See, she deserves no compassion or leniency," Vishwamitra remarked. "Fulfill your duty, kill her and put an end to this reign of terror," he reminded Rama. He shot an arrow into the wilderness around them. With a blood-curdling cry, Taraka crashed to the ground. Her fall caused the earth to shake. Birds and animals ran amok at the terrifying noise. Trees cracked under the strong wind caused by her gigantic body hitting the ground. I think that was probably one of the first demons or foes that Ram had defeated. So you can take your own takeaway or learning from that story and figure out who is evil and who is good and what is it that needs to be done. Back to the Pika.
Thank you so much, Mom. Like, we are running out of the time, or else we would have definitely go for the Q&A, but time is already up. So let's move forward for the vote of thanks. On the behalf of Orange City Literature Festival, we sincerely express our gratitude towards your acceptance for the session and knowledge shared with us. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you for joining in. Thank you, Deepika, for the wonderful introduction and the vote of thanks. And thank you, Orange City Literature Festival.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Twenty years of existence. Two universities. 23 educational institutes. Offering 137 courses. Rice Oni Group of Institutions, a vision beyond.